Welcome to the first episode of For the Love of Food. Those of you who know me know that I prefer not to be in the spotlight, but my husband Dave pitched the idea of holding a cooking show while we're hunkering down during this pandemic. I thought about it, and at first I was a little reluctant, but he said, hey, it would be a fun thing to do. It would allow us to connect with people virtually, share some recipes, and hopefully have some laughs along the way. On a more serious note though, I would like to dedicate this show to all of our healthcare workers and our first responders that are serving at this time. I know all of us have friends and family, so I just want to dedicate this to my sister Jo, my niece Molly, and our dear friend Maggie, and thank them for their service. And I know all of us have loved ones or friends that are doing the same. So my other inspiration to do this, besides Dave's little nudging, was my other CIO. That's my work CIO. So I work for Pat Maroney, and during this crisis, Pat has been doing some journal entries. He's calling them Thoughts from the Bunker, and with every entry, he has some themes. So one of the themes was change, and it talked about how change causes growth. So I thought about what Dave said, and I thought, you know, this isn't in my comfort space, but let's go ahead and give it a try. So thanks to Dave, thanks to Pat, and that is what got me here. The other thing that Pat wrote about in his Thoughts from the Bunker was how important it is to have hobbies. So cooking is obviously one of my hobbies, so I encourage you to pick up a hobby as you're in this shelter-in-place period. One of Pat's ideas was to start a cooking blog. Little did he know, starting a cooking show might be one of my new hobbies. So thanks to both Dave and Pat for encouraging, and for Dave for suggesting this idea. So what most of you do know about me is that I love food and I love cooking. And I feel that I attribute that love to my parents. Both of my parents were 100% Polish. So for those of you that know the Eastern European culture, food is a really big part of that culture. So growing up, I had many traditions that revolved around food. At Christmas Eve, we did what was called vigilia, and it was a many course meal on Christmas Eve. We also had many traditions during Easter that revolved around food. And then most importantly, we had weekly Sunday meals with my extended family. My mom's sisters, Aunt Elle and Aunt Lil, would come over every Sunday, and they would spend the day in our kitchen cooking up wonderful meals. We'd have a second oven in the basement, so I have memories of going downstairs and working in the basement oven. But it was when I was alongside them, watching them, learning from them, and cooking with them that I really got my love of cooking. So in the spirit of food and family, I'm gonna go ahead and make a recipe today that was from my Grandma Olszewski. That was my dad's mom. And Grandma Olszewski used to make what we call Grandma's meat rolls. Now, Grandma Olszewski used to make homemade bread dough, but I'm gonna do a little shortcut today, and I'm gonna use a frozen bread dough to do this. So this is really only three main ingredients. It's the frozen bread dough, 1 pound of ground beef, and then a half of a large onion. What I typically like to do is use Rhodes frozen bread dough. This bag has 36 frozen bread balls in it, and I typically would use 12 of these for 1 pound of ground beef. So all you have to do is take your cooking spray, and I usually like to do a 9x13 Pyrex pan, and then just take 12 of your frozen bread balls, and you want to place them in the pan. Now, what's important is that you place them a couple inches apart. So that's why I like the 9x13 pan, because it allows you to give space. These are gonna double in size, and there's many instructions on the back of this bag for thawing, but what I like to do is let them thaw on your countertop for 3 to 5 hours before you're ready to cook them. So I know that you just kind of have to plan around that, but as long as it's, you know, a Saturday or Sunday, just 3 to 5 hours before you're ready to bake them, put them in the pan, coat it with cooking spray, make sure they're spaced apart, and then I'd also take a piece of plastic wrap, spray the plastic wrap with the cooking spray, and then put that on top. And literally leave them on your countertop, on your stovetop. They can be at room temperature, all right? So that's that portion of it. So the only real key there is to allow the 3 to 5 hours to let them thaw. So the other part of it is your 1 pound of ground beef.
Okay, so, I had a comment from Bev Geidish. I have to say this. She says the bread balls are social distancing in the pan. Good for them.
Thank
Sorry.
You, Bev. Thanks for the laugh. We love the Geidishes. So the next thing is 1 pound of ground beef. So I'm using 1 pound of Wallace Farms 8015 ground beef. This is a little shout out to Wallace Farms. It's a farm in Keystone, Iowa. You can order online and they deliver every other week to Naperville North, right across from the baseball field in the little strip mall. And Nick Wallace is the farmer, and Nick will be there when you go to pick up your food. And I cannot tell you how much I love actually looking into the eyes of the farmer that produced this meat. So 1 pound of ground beef, 1 onion. I usually use a half of a large onion, or you could use 1 small onion. Just do a normal dice on that onion. And then what you're gonna wanna do is take your skillet, and this is really similar to if you're just making ground beef for tacos. Take your skillet, put the ground beef in, the 1 pound, go ahead and brown it for about 5 minutes, then take your chopped onion, add it to the pan. I usually do about 1 teaspoon of salt and 1/2 teaspoon of black pepper, and go ahead and just brown that. It may take, you know, 20 minutes or so to brown that, but go ahead and brown the meat and the onion together. The key is your salt and your pepper. Because there is minimal ingredients in this, you really want to add your flavor with the salt and the pepper. My grandma used to really pepper hers up. So go ahead and brown the beef and the onion, and you're going to want to allow enough time for that to cool. So that is what we're going to do right now with regards to the meat roll. So you've got your bread dough thawing and you've got your meat browning with your onions. So I'm going to switch to our dessert. When Dave said this, he thought meat rolls would be fun, and he said, what about a dessert? So we decided to make molten lava cakes. So these are chocolate lava cakes. And I don't know about you, but I've had these in restaurants before, and they've always had this mystery around them. You've always wondered how, when you put that spoon in the middle, is the ooey gooey center always come flowing out of it. So a few years ago, I decided to try to make these, and I found a really simple recipe to do this. Once again, these are ingredients that you most likely have at home. It's chocolate chips, it's butter, it's flour, it's sugar, and it's egg. So those are really simple ingredients, and we're gonna get started with the lava cakes. So what you wanna have is a medium bowl with 4 tablespoons of butter, and then to that bowl, I'm gonna add 1 cup of chocolate chips. And you're gonna go ahead and place that in your microwave. We're going to start with 30 seconds, and this is where you have to do a few iterations. So we're going to do 30 seconds, and after the 30 seconds are up, we're going to take it out, we're going to take a spatula, and we're going to just mix it a little bit. And you're going to do this maybe about 3 or 4 iterations. When I start the next iteration, I'm going to do 20 seconds, and I'll keep doing 20 seconds until that chocolate is thoroughly melted and nice and smooth, okay? So we're just about done with our first 30 seconds, and I'll go ahead and open it, and I'll bring it out so you could see it. And we're just gonna do a little mix. You can see the butter actually melted already in just those first 30 seconds. So I'm just gonna keep mixing this, and then I'm gonna put it back in for 20 seconds. another 20 seconds, and probably another one or two times this will be ready to go. So the other ingredients that you're going to want to have with this is 2 eggs. One egg will be a whole egg. The other egg we're going to separate, and we're just going to use the yolk. So it'll be one whole egg and one egg yolk. So let's see how our second 20 seconds look. You can see how it really melts fairly quickly, and you just want to keep mixing it to incorporate that butter with those chocolate chips.
Yum.
So I'm going to give it one more whirl, and I think we're going to be good at that point. So one more 20 seconds. While that's going, let me talk about the rest of the ingredients. I have 2 tablespoons of granulated sugar, and I have 1 tablespoon of flour. So what we're going to do next after the chocolate is done is we're going to start with the eggs and the sugar.
Okay, I'm getting a question on the, is it milk chocolate or bittersweet on the chocolate?
It's bittersweet. I am using just regular semi-sweet chocolate chips, but the chocolate is bittersweet chocolate. And just so you know, Dave will share all these recipes after the show. But good question. It is bittersweet chocolate. I am just using your traditional chocolate chips in this recipe. So now you'll see that this chocolate is melted and it's very smooth, okay? So like I said, I start with 30 seconds and then I usually do about 2 other rounds of about 20 seconds. So there's our chocolate. So our chocolate is done. Next, we're gonna go to our egg. So I said one whole egg. So I'm gonna crack my one whole egg into my bowl. And next, we're gonna do 1 egg yolk. So I'm gonna separate the egg. So I have a separate bowl here. I'm gonna go ahead and crack it open, and then I'm gonna use the back and forth, just using my shell to separate my egg. Okay, so now I have my egg whites in my bowl and I have my second egg yolk in my bowl. So to my eggs, I'm going to add my 2 tablespoons of granulated sugar. And now we just have to blend these two together. Okay, so we're gonna take our mixer, and this is gonna mix for about 1 minute. We want it to thicken up a little bit and we want it to lighten in color some. So we're just gonna do about 1 minute of this. I hope you can hear me over the mixer. I wanted to share a cute little story while I'm mixing. As you see, I tried to prep all of our ingredients, which of course this never happens in my daily cooking. I'm always scrambling, just grabbing things from the cabinets and really racing. But there have been a couple occasions where I've been either having a rough day at work and it's been a crazy day, and I have a meal planned for dinner, but as I'm driving home, I'm talking to Dave and he'll say, "What can I do to help you? What can I do to help get dinner ready?" And there have been a few times when that happens and I actually come home and Dave has taken the recipe and he has prepped all the ingredients. And it is the most adorable, sweetest, thoughtful thing. I'll come home and every little bowl and container like this is prepped with all my ingredients. And I can just walk in the door, and on those days, I feel like I'm on a cooking show. He's laughing because he didn't know I was gonna say this piece.
No.
So anyway, it's really, really sweet when he's done all my prepping for me. Okay, so we have our whole egg and our egg yolk with our 2 tablespoons of sugar. And now we're just gonna add in our chocolate mixture. So we'll just get all that melted goodness in with the eggs. And we also are going to add 1 tablespoon of flour. And Dave wants to lick the spoon. This is what always happens in our house. So we're gonna add in the 1 tablespoon of flour. So there's really very little flour in this recipe. So now we're just gonna mix this together. In this case, when you're mixing this, you just really want everything to be combined. So I'm just mixing it to combine everything. And literally, this is how simple this recipe is. The one other thing I want to add is these are going to bake at a 450 degree oven. So those are good right there. Okay. And what I do when I make this recipe, it was 4 tablespoons of butter, 1 cup of chocolate chips, 2 eggs, 1 whole, 1 yolk, 2 tablespoons of sugar, and 1 tablespoon of flour. When I make that quantity, I use 3 of these ramekins. And these ramekins, they say they're 3.5-inch ramekins. I've tested them, they hold 6 ounces of water. I find that this volume of batter actually works really well in this quantity. So if you want to, you could double this recipe. It might just take you a few more iterations of melting the chocolate chips. The other thing is you're gonna wanna take some soft butter and spread that inside the ramekin, and then take a little flour and just tap the flour around the ramekin so that you have a butter and floured ramekin. So you can see what's in there now, all right? So now I'm just gonna evenly divide this mixture into the 3 ramekins. And you know, like whenever you're doing this, it's just a matter of evening it out. I start with 1 and I keep adding to all of them, and I just kind of go back and check to make sure they're as even as possible. Okay, so we're just adding those. Now the other thing I do when I make these is with this size ramekin, they do not overflow. However, I do put them on a cookie sheet because these ramekins get really hot. And as you've probably tried before, when you're using a ramekin in the oven, it's really hard to grasp it, even with a pot holder in that situation. So I do like to put them on a cookie sheet, and that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna place them on a cookie sheet. My oven has been preheating to 450 degrees. So I'm gonna go ahead and get these in the oven. So I'm gonna place them on my cookie sheet and get them in the oven. I'll just give them a little wipe real quick to clean them up. Okay, so these are going in our 450 degree oven. Now I'm gonna do these for 8 minutes. What I found is I usually like to check them at 8 minutes, and they should start kind of coming apart from the side, and then we'll check them again and probably give them 2 more minutes, okay? So now that we have our dessert in the oven, let's go back to our grandma's meat rolls. So you saw what I do to thaw the bread dough. I do have some rolls that have been thawing for probably thawed for about 4 to 5 hours, and look at the difference. So you can see that these have doubled, if not tripled, in size. Okay, so that's what you're gonna get after those are just sitting out. You're gonna see how they are going to double or triple in size. So now it's time to fill those little bundles of love. So my Matthew is gonna help me with this exercise just to make it go quicker. So we're gonna bring around our bread dough, and we're gonna get our ground beef. Okay. So give us 1 second while we get ready to prep those. I'm gonna put these back because these were just for display. And we'll start stuffing our meat rolls, okay?
Say hi to Matthew.
So hey, Matthew is my little sous chef. He is a great cook. And one thing I do, whenever I do, so we've got our ground beef, right, that we talked about. It's what we did. We took our pound of ground beef. We cooked it for about 5 minutes, add the chopped onion, and then added about 1 teaspoon of salt and about 1/2 teaspoon of black pepper. Now notice what I'm doing. To make sure that I'm evenly filling these, I like to take my ground beef and section it off. So I first divide it in half, then I divide it in quarters, and then I divide it in the other half in quarters. So now I've got 3/4. So it just kind of helps me when I'm starting to fill them to make sure that I'm not overfilling or underfilling and I'm not gonna end up with a lot of extra beef or too little beef. So now I know that each one of these little sections, I should fill 3 of the meat rolls, okay? So here's what I was talking about though. This dough really, really sticks together. So Matthew and I are each gonna take one of these little sections, and what you're gonna wanna do, it's kinda like pizza dough, right? You're just taking a section.
Sorry, and Laura Snyder says, fractions. She's a math teacher, folks.
Thanks, Laura, that's awesome. So we are taking this, and I would say probably like a 4-inch diameter is what you're looking for, and it really doesn't have to be perfect, okay? But you're gonna put it in the palm of your hand. I'm right-handed, so I am going to take a scoop, and once again, I'm trying to take 1/3 of my section because I'm gonna use each section for 3 rolls. And then you literally fold it over. You bring the sides together and then you pinch the ends, okay? And there you have it. You have your little bundle and it sticks really nicely together. And that's what one of them looks like. So now Matthew and I are gonna continue to fill these up, okay? And one of the things I was thinking as I was making these is my grandmother, this is exactly what she did for the filling. She would do ground beef, onion, salt and pepper, and I said she really peppered hers up. But I was thinking there's probably some fun things you can add in these, and I've never done it because these are just, you know, our tradition. But what you could do is you could maybe saute some mushrooms if you like mushrooms, and you can add mushrooms in with it too. So that's, you know, just an idea of something you might want to do. So use your creativity and whatever else you'd like to do to fill these, you totally can do. The other thing that we're going to do after we have these made is we are going to brush them with egg wash. So egg wash is where you just take one egg. And you could do 2 tablespoons of water or a little bit more than 1 tablespoon of water. And you just beat the egg and add the water with it. And what you're gonna do is just brush the top of these meat rolls. And that's what gives it that really nice sheen when you're done with them. So
we're getting a comment from the gallery here. Laura Schneider says, my mom made a version of these and put in chopped spinach and Parmesan cheese.
Love it. That sounds really good, Laura. Thank you for the idea. So in case you couldn't hear Dave, Laura's mom added spinach and Parmesan cheese. I think the cheese idea is fabulous too. And I love the spinach because you're getting some veggies in there too. So that is the other thing that I thought about, and my friend Amy had mentioned this as far as just making these rolls, is some of you probably have the everything bagel topping, and I was thinking it might be good after you put your egg wash on if you actually took that everything bagel seasoning, and if you sprinkled that seasoning on top of the egg wash and baked it, that would give you extra flavor. So that was something I haven't tried, but it does sound like a good little treat that we could do in addition. You're seeing why you have to spread these so much, because as you're making these, as they rise, they get really, really big and they really start touching each other. So you really have to separate, you know, keep them as separate as possible. If you want, you can use a bigger pan to do so. But we're almost done. We only have 3 more to go. So now that I'm getting at the end, I'm gonna section off my meat one more time. It really, don't stress out about your quantity of meat. I've made these so many times and they always turn out. There's never a time where I feel that there's, you know, some with too little meat or too much meat. Somehow it always works out. So don't stress around that. I just gave you the tip of sectioning off the meat just as kind of a guide to help you. Okay, so we are down to our final two. Matthew and I will share up the rest of the beef and we will be ready to put our egg wash on. The other thing I wanna just mention is it is okay when you're putting them in the pan before you bake them, it is okay for them to be nestled right next to each other. They're fine. You just kind of pull them apart after they bake. So don't worry about spacing. Okay, our chocolate, I'm gonna give it two more minutes and I'll check them as soon as we're done here. So those are just about done. So we're gonna finish up. We did great, Matthew, on our ground beef proportioning. So we'll go ahead and finish this up with our egg wash, okay? So our last little bundle is done. We're gonna put it in the pan. And now we're gonna go ahead and do our egg wash. So once again, I took one egg and about 2 tablespoons of water, 1 or 2 tablespoons of water, and I have my pastry brush. And I'm just gonna do, this is always the fun part because you kind of feel like you're painting. And I'm just gonna brush the egg wash over all of these. And like I said, this is gonna give it that nice sheen and give it a nice shine. So we'll just do our little brushing. And as soon as these are done, we are gonna go back to our chocolate lava cakes and take those out of the oven. So a couple more brushes here. And we will be done with our grandma's meat rolls. So really, you'll see that once you allow the time for the bread dough to rise, and you know, browning up the meat really isn't that hard. So it really isn't that hard. So I'm gonna switch gears and we're gonna go back to the oven and we're gonna check out our lava cakes, okay? So they've been in the oven about 10 minutes. You'll notice that they're starting to separate from the sides. So I think we are done with these.
Come over here.
And I'm gonna bring them back over here. Okay. And you wanna let them sit for not a long time. They can sit for just about 15 seconds or so. But what we're gonna do is we're gonna take, I like to use my little offset spatula. You can use a butter knife or, you know, whatever you have that you can just cut around the outside of the ramekin. So I'm gonna use this. I'm gonna give them a couple more seconds while we're waiting. And then you're gonna wanna have some powdered sugar ready. These are good alone with powdered sugar sprinkled on them, or they're really good with some vanilla ice cream on the side in a bowl, or you can whip some heavy cream and add those to them. But in either case, they're just really easy. As you saw, the ingredients are things you most likely have at home. So I'm just taking my spatula or a butter knife and I am just running it around the edges, okay? Remember, these are really hot when you first take them out of the oven. So I'm just running around the edge. I'm gonna grab my pot holder for a minute and make sure that they are loosened, okay? And then the next part is the flip, where we are gonna flip them out of these ramekins. So what I like to do is take one of my plates and I'm gonna take it this way first. I'm gonna put my ramekin down. It's really, really hot. I'm gonna put my plate over it and I'm gonna just flip it over and we're gonna lift it up. And there you go. You have your first lava cake. I'm gonna put some powdered sugar on top of it. And we'll go ahead and plate the rest of them. And of course, we will take one of them and we will cut into the middle to see if the middle is all nice and ooey gooey, full of that chocolate lava. So you'll see, because we put the butter and the flour inside, they really do come out easy as long as you just take your knife or your offset spatula. They really, really do come out easily. Okay, so there we go. There are our three. And let's take a spoon and let's dig into one and see what the middle looks like. So there it is. There you see your gooey lava in the middle of your chocolate cake. So those are pretty easy. As far as the meat rolls, now that we have them ready, filled, and we brushed with our egg wash, you're gonna put those into a 350 degree preheated oven. And I would bake them for 15 minutes, but then check them after the 15, maybe do another 5. And this is what they're gonna look like when you take them out of the oven. So here you have our 12 meat rolls. You'll see that you have your sheen on the top of them. And this is what I mean. They can be nice and close together because they're just gonna break apart just like a roll would. And when you open them inside, there you have all your ground beef and your onions. My family loves these. They like them for dinner with a salad on the side, or Dave loves them for lunch. They're so portable, they're so easy to eat. You can just take one, eat it with your hand. So they're really either a nice snack, a nice dinner, a nice lunch. And that's it. So that is our first episode of For the Love of Food. We did our grandma's meat rolls. We did our chocolate lava cakes. Dave will post all these recipes. And thank you for joining us. And I hope that maybe this inspires you to do some cooking while we are hunkered down. Okay?
Take
care.
Matthew, try a meat roll?
Bye-bye. Cook? Oh, Matthew's going to try a meat roll.
Very good.
Well. Okay, thanks guys. Thanks for laughing with us. Thanks for doing something silly with us. We hope you had some fun. For the love of food. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.